Welcome back to another episode of Sound Pals Go to the Movies. This is another Throwback Thursday review, and I'm here with my friend Tuli. Say hi, Tuli.
Hi, guys.
And today we're going to be reviewing Jaws from 1975. And just a fair warning, there's going to be spoilers up ahead, so you've been warned. When a killer shark unleashes chaos on a beach community, it's up to the local sheriff, a marine biologist, and an old seafarer to hunt the beast down. Let's start off my review by talking about the movie. So Jaws was directed by Steven Spielberg. This movie is responsible for my original fears of swimming in the ocean when I was a kid. And I guess it did the same thing for a lot of adults who went to watch the movie when it came out. But eventually, I ended up conquering my fears like Hooper in the movie, and I got over my fears faster than he did. So eventually, I ended up loving the sea, and I got attached to it just like him. In a way, Jaws made me afraid of the ocean, but then somehow it lured me back in. This movie, other than giving us childhood fears about sharks, it gives us an unforgettable music score by John Williams that pairs up with the scenes in the movie that builds up suspense as the movie progresses. Scene where they use the famous forward tracking zoom out shot for people who've seen the movie is when the sheriff Brody is sitting down and he sees the attack of the little kid in the ocean and he's sitting by the beach. This story, the music, plus camera work makes Jaws easily jump to the top of my all-time movie list. First, we start off the movie with a swimmer getting attacked, but we don't see the shark at all and our minds begin to race and create the monster. And by the end of the movie, we begin to see the front shots, side shots, and close-up shots of the actual shark, nicknamed Bruce by the movie crew. We also get some shots filmed from a low angle to sort of represent the shark's point of view. This is important because the director gave the shark power and importance other than just being a monster. I also divide this movie into two parts, one being taken part in the land and the second part being in the water. The first part being in the land is the build-up when the kills are being discovered before Brody goes after Jaws into its own territory, the ocean. In the second part of the movie, we see Brody, Hooper, and Quinn plus Jaws all basically on the ocean and on the boat. Here we get my favorite scene of the movie where Hooper and Quinn are comparing who has the best scar. This leads into a comical scene, and after that, it leads into Quinn going into his dialogue of the USS Indianapolis and talks about how the crew members got attacked by sharks. This basically, to me, represents his fear and the reason he wants to end up being at sea and confronting the shark. The way he broke the radio when Brody wanted to reach out for help is that he wants a showdown with the shark. It's his last stand. It's either him or the shark. And at the end, we do see Quinn get eaten by the shark. In a sense, it's his way of dying the way his crewmates died in the USS Indianapolis. Now, moving on to my cons, there's not much, but one of the main cons that I have, I can attribute to the length of the movie. I know it's 2 hours plus. A few people can say that it's a really long movie, but to me, in a sense, I can justify it by having it set into two parts, part one and part two. If it wasn't a movie, if it was a TV series, we can have it into like two separate episodes, sort of. But being a movie, it's quite long. Mind you, it doesn't lose your attention. Every time I sit down and watch it, it doesn't really let you down. It continues to hold its pace. There is some scenes here and there that you can cut, but other than that, the majority of the scenes does build up character, which are the three characters that I talked about, Brody, Hooper, and Quinn, but we don't see much of the shark. The shark is not a monster in this movie. He's actually, I don't want to say an afterthought. I just want to say that he is just there, but we see it at the second part of the movie. We don't see him physically. For me, those are the cons. That does it for my review. I'm going to pass it on to my friend Tuli and see how he saw the movie and what grade he gave the movie.
I think I feel pretty much the same about this movie as Sal does overall. Seeing this movie as a kid, it did bring about a sense of fear for the ocean and maybe unfairly towards sharks. I realize that they are hunters out there in the sea, but the movie did paint sharks, particularly this one particular giant shark, leading to like an overall generalization of what sharks can do. I think that's kind of where my perception of Shark really kind of began. And again, I know the movie had its narrative, but at the same time, I can't help to reflect and think that, oh, this movie was the one that made me feel this way about sharks. But strictly talking about the movie though now, the movie did bring some components into the movie industry, I feel, that so many mediums, whether through, you know, TV series, future films, or what have you, you know, they took inspiration from. At the very least, I could appreciate Jaws for this. Sal mentioned the musical score for this film. If anything, the main theme whenever Jaw is around. I'm pretty sure that this was my introduction to John Williams. The movie came out in 1975, so I think this was like one of the earliest contribution that I was aware of as a kid as to who John Williams was and how his work made films that he was a part of special, that you could always sort of hum to some of the music that he's produced and instantly bring about certain memories, thoughts, or feelings. And John Williams, I know probably maybe through countless hours of work to have come up with this theme to Jaws, for it to sound simple in a way and yet bring about this sense of tension whenever you hear the Jaws theme, I thought really set the tone for this movie. Even if we didn't see the shark that often, hearing that theme was good enough to grab your attention and anticipate what was to happen next. So I think the music in this film is one of my favorite components of it. The characters themselves, there are, I would say, 3 or 4 that really stood out. If you were to just generalize the rest of the cast and just focus on these 4 characters, which I think the movie did well with, I can see the story of this film being one that I could follow, from Brody's character, who was trying to play the good guy, although reluctantly at the beginning to accept what happened at the onset with the attack that happened, that eventually led to a kid getting killed by the shark, whose mother felt extremely bad about and took her frustration on Brody. But at the same time, you know, Brody being put in this tough position of trying to convince the mayor to not allow people to go swimming in the beach. After Brody realized that there was something wrong, he was put in a tough spot. Like, he was trying to do his job, but at the same time, there was pressure from an higher authority to hold him down. When I saw him be the recipient of the kid's mother's reaction, I felt bad for him. And so I wanted really for him to overcome the situation that he was in and wanted to know how he would overcome it. For Brody to get that final moment at the end of the film, that was very satisfying. And then, of course, I already mentioned the mayor. To me, I thought like the mayor was the biggest obstacle. And that's kind of weird to say because Jaws was a creature going around killing people, but you know, had the mayor done his job and cared more about the safety of his people, then the situation would not have gone as badly as it did here. But I thought for the most part, the role of the mayor was portrayed well enough to get me to feel that he was a major obstacle in this film for our main character Brody to overcome. And then Sal mentioned Quint, who I have mixed feelings about. I do love his character, don't get me wrong, but I feel like he's a madman. He wants revenge based on his past history, and it was clearly shown to me that he was crazy when he destroyed that device on the boat to prevent them from communicating back to land. Like, he was determined to kill Jaws, but it showed to me that he didn't care what happened to anybody who was on that boat. He wanted the shark dead, and he would go to any means to do it, even if it means jeopardizing the safety of his own crew. So to me, I do like Quint as a character, and I thought it clearly showed during the introduction of his character, the way he spoke about his desire to want to hunt this particular creature. I thought that this guy was a little offbeat. That personality was shown during the second half of the film where the 3 guys were out in the sea trying to hunt down Jaws. And for his character to end the way he did, it was, I would say, bittersweet and ironic at the same time. And gruesome. Definitely gruesome. Yeah, I love Quint's character. But for me, I thought he was like a madman. And then we have Hooper. I feel like in the same way, was trying to be the good guy, the guy with common sense, because he had knowledge about how predators, if you want to say that, how they work. And he was trying to have like a common ground with Brody to convince the mayor to not endanger his people. So I could sense the struggle that he was going through as well, especially towards Quint, because Quint, through his madman sort of state, wasn't really the best captain of his boat, the way he was treating Hooper in particular, just yelling out commands and stuff of that nature, I feel like Hooper was getting very annoyed by Quint, and for him to be able to take it and still continue on with the hunt, I can respect him for that. These four characters, I really enjoyed their interactions with one another. So alongside the music and these particular characters and how they reacted towards one another and how they advanced the story, I would say I enjoyed these components of the movie. The story itself is not very complicated. It is pretty simple. It's about a group of people who wants to kill a particular shark because the shark has been killing people in town, but it's how they get to that moment, really. Which then brings me to my cons of the movie. 2 hours long for the amount of content in this movie, at least like contents that I feel are important and would drive the story home. I thought the movie was a tad too long. I would think that maybe the movie could have done what it did with 20-25 minutes of lesser content. And I know that the conversation that happened on the boat was fascinating, but I thought that conversation lasted for way too long. I thought it was dragging. There were certain aspects within the conversation that was important to explaining how their character was, but I felt that these sort of integrations of dialogue could have maybe happened throughout the film somehow, so that when we get to this point, we don't hit this scene where it's just basically about talking. I think maybe this was a way for Steven Spielberg to at least have a moment while the guys are out there in the sea and just waiting for the shark, because what else could they be doing out there? But for me, I wish the conversation would have been more condensed to just having talked about the key stuff. As Sal mentioned, you know, the USS Indianapolis, how Hooper and Quint, how they got their scars. You know, I thought those sort of things could have happened in a more condensed fashion. I think out of all the scenes in this movie that I felt that this little sort of negativity towards, it was this particular scene, because I was just thinking, oh, the movie's dragging here. Come on, guys, get it going. But other than that, I don't have too many other complaints about the film. So I'm going to give this film an 8 out of 10. If for anything, just the impact that this film had in movie industry and the score of the movie, because John Williams easily became one of my favorite composers to films, and it made me want to watch films knowing that he was a part of it. So kudos to John Williams and Steven Spielberg, of course, as well, for being able to create something that instill fear and instill inspiration into future works to come.
I agree with you, and kudos to you for dissecting the characters on the boat. I really enjoyed how you did that. First, we have Brody, who he's there for the human life. Quinn, who is for revenge. And Hooper, for the science community, or for just knowledge. And the mayor, he's in it for just the money. That's why he didn't want to close the beaches. So we can see it that way. Everybody had their own investment. The shark was just a shark. We can just put it that way. And the movie did do that it got people to fear sharks when sharks are not really that hungry killing machines as they were portrayed. Even Steven Spielberg has said that he is sorry that he portrayed them in that negative light. That leads me to another thing. John Williams, let's focus on him. He's amazing, like Tuli said. Because of him, we have scores that are amazing from this movie and other movies. So if you don't know who John Williams is, he does not only make scores for movies. If you're a football fan, he has done the score for Monday Night Football. So this guy is amazing. So if you don't know who he is, look him up. So I'm going to give this movie a high grade of a 9 out of 10. The only thing, like Tuli said, the movie is a little long. Other than that, this movie for me is phenomenal. So I guess that does it for this review of Jaws. Please join us next time where we're going to review The Invisible Man from 1933.
Bandages right up to the top of his head, all round his ears.
Any blood?
No blood. Looks like some kind of horrible accident.
Please like, comment, and subscribe. You can find our social media links below. And like always, keep watching movies.